You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Time once again for Bruce Smirnoff, who
Hi, David.
Reports to us from Delray Beach in Florida. Hello, sir.
What's happening?
Well, it's the July 4th week, and I can't think of a nicer place to be than Florida during the summer.
When they invented air conditioning, it became habitable. What is the, what's the word? What is the word? Habitable?
Livable. No, livable.
Livable. But before air conditioning, you know, there's a place called the Boca Resort in Boca Raton, and it's a real famous hotel. It's like built in the 20s, so it's got that old, like that Los Angeles Spanish look, and it's just gorgeous. And it was built by this guy Meisner, and there's a lot of things down in Florida named after Meisner. But it shows a picture of him in like a wool suit in the summer. It's like July 18th, you know, 1924, and he's there all shaved with the hair, and you just see the guy in those days they wore wool suits with vests, so the guy's wearing a wool suit and a vest. You just look at the picture and you start to sweat when you look at the picture. You go, how did these people, much less, you know, live down here without air conditioning? But did you watch Boardwalk Empire?
I couldn't get into it. My family watched it.
You know, I'll tell you something about it. I never liked that show for like three seasons because it was filmed so dark that you always had a strain to see things. And then something clicked, and I don't know what it was, but I got into it, and I wound up loving it. But yeah, it took me like 3 years of negativity to accept it. Anyway, they did a thing where they would go to Cuba. They were bootleggers or whatever, and they really they did that. You know, this is before air conditioning, and everybody's with a hat, you know, a straw hat and a suit, and they're dancing. So people must have really, you know, you really perspired into your clothing back then. You know,
you would think with air conditioning, people would dress the way they dressed back then. But now, even with air conditioning, we're showing more skin. Makes no sense.
Yeah. Well, that's just the casualness of society. I mean, I don't know how many people listening are into fashion. I don't know much about fashion. I just kind of like certain things. Like I like suits, and I do like really cool shoes. When you look at the suits and the shoes of the 20s, I mean, that was one of the best eras of all that. I mean, beautiful, beautiful stuff. But yeah, people just, I guess after World War II, this casualness. You know, if you ever watch World War II documentaries, which I do like every 15 minutes when I'm not on this show with you, you see that right at the end of World War II, people's hairstyles change, everything. You went in, like World War II, you went in with that look of the 30s with very cropped hair and everything, very conservative. And then you popped like 46, 47, and women were in bikinis and had that long, you know, had long hair like those, I'm blanking on those movie stars, but they changed their hairstyles. And then it went back, like by 52, 53, it became repressed again. But there was that window from like, 46 to 49 where they look like today. They look like the early 60s then is what they look like.
I think there was a lot of sex after the war, kind of like after World War One, and the flappers and the roaring 20s. I think people came back from the war and there was a lot of sex.
You know, you're right. A lot of this begins with the haircuts and the everything is like on the VJ parade. I was watching that the other day in Times Square. And yeah, well, the men were still in the service, so I guess their hair was still military cut. But the women, yes, that's when they just had this cool look all of a sudden. Oh, it's the PBS thing I was watching by Ken Burns.
Right.
And it shows that, yeah, it just like almost happened overnight where they got really cool looking,
well,
you know, by our standards.
Sex really took off in the 70s, not the 60s. And I think after the Vietnam War, disco and sex and cocaine. So
right.
If you want to have sex, get your country into a war
and then there's about a two-year window where everybody has sex.
Yeah.
That will help.
Because, I guess because they see so much death and so, just so much death. They want to see more life and produce people.
Speaking of sex.
Yes.
You and I share Eric Weber. I interviewed Eric Weber when I was going to college. There was a radio station.
Yeah.
And they played jazz and they had professors. And my friend Andy Kaplow ran the station. It's a very highbrow radio station. And I got to host Book Notes. They would interview people who wrote books about Joyce, people who wrote books about Lionel Trilling. And one week I hosted and I brought in Eric Weber for Book Notes. And boy, were people pissed off that I interviewed Eric Weber. Tell everybody who Eric Weber is.
Well, Eric Weber wrote this book called How to Pick Up Girls. And I believe he wrote this book, I don't know, like in the 60s. Maybe the...
No, it was the 80s. It was the 80s.
No. I got the book in 1980, so he couldn't have written it then. He had to have written it somewhere in the late... Or let's say 75 or something, whatever. And I had moved to L.A. in 1978, and I was like a nerdy kind of guy, and I just couldn't get women to like me. And then I went and moved to like the hippest place on earth where you got to be producing something for a woman in order for them to be attracted to you. And I wasn't. I was like a loser with no act. And it was hard for me to even get on stage. And my whole life was to be a comedian. And I couldn't get a girl to look at me. And I had no experience. I didn't have my first sexual experience till I was like 19 or 20. No, 20, actually. So I was really hurting. I had an amazing sex libido like every guy does, and I couldn't do anything about it. So I was so dejected, and I had one of those, dirty magazines, and I was opening it up, and, it always opens to the back, and there was that ad, how to pick up girls. Hey, guys, we can change you. And, everybody sees that, and everyone ignores it, but I guess I had reached a nadir of my life. And I said, I got to try this. So I mailed away for it. And it's so funny. I'll never forget this. I wrote a check. I think the book was $12.95 in 1980. I mailed the check. I think it was like on a Monday. And it had to go to New Jersey. I think that's where the press house was. And I think like Tuesday afternoon it came. It came like in 9 hours. And this is before Federal Express. I just never got something in the mail so quick in 1980. I just remember going, man, that was quick. Holy mackerel. So
it's a good thing it wasn't How to Cure Premature Ejaculation.
So I get the book and I read it. And it's so fundamental. It's so like, A, B, C. And it's written like talking to a moron, but you know what it's like? It's like talking to a guy in the army who is going to operate an M60 machine gun. So you have to go, this is a very dangerous weapon. Be very careful, but it's going to kill lots of people. So here we go, and put the bullet in, don't aim it at your foot, so it's like, and you're going like, I know what a gun is. Hey, I can put a bullet, and yet this has to. But people go and they shoot each other all the time. So this is, you have to. So every guy thinks he can, talk to women or say what women want to hear. And this book, it was incredible. It was so idiotic and simple, and yet everything you read in it, you go, oh geez, yeah, and you put everything together. I don't know how deep you want to go with this. You want to know some of the things? I mean, he would say, like, he would talk about grooming, like shave. And I go, well, I don't have to worry about that. I mean, I know how to shave and I like, and I wear clean clothing. But there are so many. But one of the biggest things was smile. You're picking up a girl. I think that was one of the chapters or one of the headings that he had. And it's like when a guy's trying to meet women, it's so serious to him. He's just so...
Well, wait a second. Wait, now I'm thinking about this for a second.
Yeah.
He wrote the book in the 70s. How hard was it to pick up girls in the 70s?
Well, how hard is it? Let me explain. Very hard. It's hard for
even in the 70s?
Yeah, I mean, there are certain guys that have it, or there are certain guys that can get liquored up. and seem like to be the life of the party. But I would say 97% of other men aren't that way. And especially when you meet a woman, your emotional heartstrings are being pulled, your insecurities as a human being, everything that you don't think about. And that's what these books talk about. And you can lose it. We have a mutual friend. I can't mention his name, but he's the greatest guy. This guy's 64 years old, and he still chases after 18-year-olds. But the funny thing about him is he's always immaculately dressed, and he's a very secure guy, and he's a very aggressive, well-spoken gentleman. But when he sees a woman, he loses it. He gets like Tourette's syndrome. He starts to tweak, and he says stupid things, and he comes off like a first-class idiot within 8 seconds. And his defense mechanism, instead of using humor, and he's a genius at humor, is he insults people. So he's trying to hit – he's insulting a woman, and he's trying to get the like of – he's insulting her. It's crazy. And they're like, look at him. Like, who the blank are you moron? And this guy's 64. He hasn't figured it out yet. He should read this book. So I'm reading this book in 1980. I'm going, yeah, I don't smile. I'm so serious about trying to meet a girl, and you got to have fun, and you got to before you walk into the place where the women are, like a bar in those days or at a party, tell yourself a joke. Always be smiling. Don't. And if the girl is beautiful, these are all such simple things. But when you put it all together, it's amazing.
So it worked. It worked.
Well, I'll get to that. So I read the whole book. And I'm making Mario, and I'm making notes and the whole thing. And then at the end of the book, it says, you must go out and practice this formula for 30 days. I guarantee you, I think he had a money back guarantee on the book. I guarantee you this book will work, or your money back, whatever. So I started and practiced. And I know we have a lot of liberated people listening, so I apologize if there's liberated women listening, but 20, like 40.
By the way, liberated, very up-to-date term. Very. Oh,
what's so, the word I'm looking for then?
Human.
All right, whatever it is, any of you pissed off women are not going to like this. But within like 24 days, I met this blonde at the improv. Her name was Candy, and she was so hot. I'd never in my life thought I could ever be with a woman like this. And I did everything you're supposed to do. And I was making love to her. Listen to this.
Wow.
Beverly Hills on the roof of her condo building. And now this is what because we left after the improv. So it's like about 1:45, 2 a.m. on a Sunday night. And we're outside on the roof in Beverly Hills making love. And I'm like looking up, thank you, God, thank you, everyone. You know, and you hear, you know, in Beverly Hills, you can't park overnight from 2:30 to 5 a.m. You get like a $150 ticket. So while I'm in the middle of making love to this woman, I hear, you know, the scooter that gives you the ticket. And I go, I'm getting a ticket. I go, this is the most worth it ticket. And I look up again. I said, thank you, God. It was the best $125 I ever got fined for. And it was sensational. Absolutely textbook. And ever since then,
So the book works.
The book works. That woman, Candy, the weirdest thing, I tried calling her like a few weeks. I saw her like 8 months. I mean, she never went out with me again. It was just one of those things. Then I saw her like 8 months later, and she had turned into a lesbian, and she changed her name to Brian. It was the craziest thing I had ever experienced in my life, because she was like a hottie hot hot. You would not expect her to become a lesbian and change her name to Brian. And this was like, and I'm 20, what am I, 22? Well, I'm 24. I'm 24 years old, and I don't know people changing their gender and names. You're a hot babe. What do you got to become a lesbian for? They're not known for being hot. They look like Joe Friday and Bill Gates. You know, what are you doing?
Joe Friday.
And I couldn't figure things out back then. But yeah, that was, yeah, Brian. And that was it. I saw her maybe one or two. I didn't go out with her because she was a lesbian, but I saw her at the improv, and that was that. But that was
28 days into the book, every day you practiced.
Eric Weber, so if you're listening, you changed my life. And
Candy's. You changed her into Candy's. Brian.
changed it. We changed genders. Yeah, Candy thanks you too. Or Brian. Yes, Brian thanks you.
I ran into Eric Weber at a film festival. I was emceeing the Sonoma Film Festival, yeah. I don't know, about 10 years ago. And this guy named Eric Weber is sitting in the audience, and he's a movie producer. And I walk up to him, and he's wearing a suit, and he looks all Hollywood. I say, are you Eric Weber from How to Pick Up Girls? And he looks around. He goes, yeah, but I'm a movie producer now.
Wow.
So he says to be nice. There's the other theory.
I'm going to look him up and send him like a thank you card. I did not know that he was still active.
Yeah. There's the game. That's the new thing. The game, well, penetrating the secret society of pickup artists.
And that I don't know. Let's fast forward. Then there was a guy named Ross Jeffries in L.A. who's like a tall. He actually a similar look to me, a tall, skinny, Jewishy looking fellow. And, you know, not a horrible looking guy, but you know, along the lines that he looks like that guy. What's that character's name from that show? Saved by the Bell. What was that guy's
Screech?
Name? Screech. Sort of like an older Screech type of guy. And he had these seminars. He would have them at the, I think he still does maybe. I don't know. But he would have them like at the LAX Hilton, because people would fly in. This is before computers, but he had cassette tapes, he had manuals, and he would have these like weekend seminars, and he was powerful. The difference between him and Eric Weber was Eric Weber was like a lighthearted romp. You know, here's how you meet girls, what you do with them after you meet them. He didn't exactly go on to that. But Eric Weber is like a guy.
No, not Eric Weber, the other guy.
No, excuse me. Sorry. Ross Jeffries is like a guy who stands at his bedpost with a giant machete, Jim Bowie knife, and goes, okay, one just left. Let's make the notch. All right, get a close-up. We're making a notch. Well, the notch is going in. Let's make it longer. We're going to make a long notch today. So that's the difference between him and Eric Weber. But this guy, what Ross Jeffries was after a while, this pickup thing.
Wait a second. Did you go to Ross Jeffries?
I think I did, but I used to watch his videos, so I can't remember if I actually went. Yes, I was there. Here's where I was. I was there for Rosh Hashanah. Schwartzy. Used to have this rabbi. Used to have
Schwartzy. We just lost Schwartzy.
I know. May he rest in peace.
Yes.
He was a great. But he used to have his Rosh Hashanah services at the LAX. In the next room. With Ross Jeffries giving a seminar. So I said, screw the ceremony. I went into the Ross Jeffries. You got Jesus in one room. I like the high holy days praying. And I'm going, so you take the bra and you pull the bra off. And, oh my God, that's what is that unbelievable?
But if I remember Schwartzy, after the services, he walk up to you and go, so, did you learn anything about picking up chicks?
So Ross Jeffries would go to Oprah, and he had like a man. He's an interesting character. I never met him personally. I just was in the back of the room watching him. But here's his thing. What happened was this Eric Weber technique works, you know, in real live America. You know, hi, my name is Sonia. Let's go out and let's see where it goes. But what happened was Ross Jeffries, I think, was a L.A. native, or at least he spent a lot of time there, and he dealt with these cuckoos. The girls in L.A., I'm sure they're that way all around America now, because all the girls watch TV and they emulate these actresses and they do what they do. But at the time, let's say like the late 80s, early 90s, women where, you know, with like, you know, can I have your phone number? No, you give me your number. Or can I have your phone number? And they give you like a voicemail. So nothing worked the traditional way. You would call a woman and go, hi, my name is Bruce. I met you the other night. Here's my number. Call me back. And see, it would just be these terrible dances back and forth. So Ross Jeffries had like a guerrilla style and teaching you how to, like, if you'd meet a girl, like, I'll give you an example. If you meet a girl like at a bar and you have a great conversation and you know, you say, I'd like to see you again. May I have your number? And a girl would say, no, give me your number. Right. Mm-hmm. So that you have to identify, that girl is not going to give you her number and you probably have no future with her. So you give it right back to her and say with a smile, no, thank you. I don't work that way, or however you get that.
Right.
And then what that does is jostle them to where they go, oh my God, this guy isn't like all the rest. And now they either want you or they say no. And everybody lives to see another day. So he was like, he taught you how to get around modern technology and modern groupthink that was developing through, I guess, the MTV mentality or whatever was on at the time. But he was, like I said, he was more into like numbers and you gotta, they're nothing but, I'll tell you who he is, the character in Magnolia.
I was just gonna say, the Tom Cruise character.
Yeah, Tom Cruise.
The power of the, you know what?
He uses the dirty words to refer to women. So, you know, he didn't have to do that, but he did do that. And so he would be, you'd have to have security, you know, you'd get a couple of women there, you know, just trying to barge in and tell him, you know, all these, you know, just yelling at him and wishing him death and all this stuff. So yes, that was that other guy. So those are the two people I got versed with. And then I went my way. But now I just, for the heck of it, like what you're talking about, it blossomed in the late 90s and all through the 2000s into, I can't believe, first of all, there's 500 books now. Where there was just one, there's 500. And how many ways can you say, smile, you're picking up a girl? I mean, how many books do you need to say, be a nice person and be genuine and try not to?
But I don't think that's the new theory. The new theory is, you know, it's like going into the bank asking for a loan. You have to look like you don't need it. The whole
thing. You always have to do that. Yeah.
So the whole thing is to act cool, detached.
Yeah.
And then if you're really into a woman, according to the game, which I'm embarrassed to say I've read, I can't put it into practice. I've seen somebody try it and it's disgusting. I mean that.
It works. That's why.
Well, okay. You neg the woman.
You what?
You neg the woman. It's called negging.
Okay, I don't know about that.
So you meet a woman and you're attracted to her and she's with her friend. Mm-hmm. What you do is you chat up her friend and make the woman you're attracted to jealous. Then you kind of ease into a conversation with her and then neg her. Say something about
her. Negative.
Something
negative. This is page two. Eric Weber.
He didn't. Yes. Eric Weber didn't say
yes.
to do that.
Here's what you do. Here you go. I mean, this is why these books are so idiotic. It's just reinventing the ball every page. It's the same thing. You go to like to meet girls. You go to cosmetic counters. This is what you did in the 70s and the 80s. And let's say the girl is 6 feet tall, beautiful blonde hair, and absolutely gorgeous. Well, you can't tell her, you can't ever make a joke about being tall because she hears that from every jerk. Remember, you don't want to be a jerk. This is where your negging comes from. So you go, oh, thank you very much. Boy, I'm new, I'm working at a comedy club. Whatever it is, you start the conversation with her, but you never tell her that she's tall. You never make a joke about that because every idiot tells, hey, how's the weather up there? what size shoe are you? You never say anything like that. And then you never tell them that they're beautiful because, again, hey, you're prettier than Miss Crabtree. You know, it's mm-hmm. that whole idiotic thing. So what you do is you be real nice to them and then you slightly put them down in a very, like, why do you have that color toenail polish? I'm just curious. You know, that's how you. That's
Jesus,
how you do
that's
it.
Evil.
It's. I know.
I couldn't do that.
I know, but this is what I mean. This is. This is what. This is what you do. Whatever you. You know. Listen. It's. Hopefully, you don't do it very long. You meet a girl. You get married, and you live happily ever after. But this is how you got to meet women, and they're in pretty women, if that's what you're looking for, are inundated every day by a gazillion guys, and you have to be different. And a lot of
game
women
playing, though, the game playing, yeah, it's exhausting. It's exhausting.
Well, not really.
I'm not into sports. You know, to me,
yeah.
I'm going to go to the gym after we record. I'm going to get on a treadmill. I'm going to run for an hour. I'm not competing against anybody. I want to get my cardio going. Same thing with sex.
Right, but you're a 60-plus-year-old man, so am I.
I'm not 60-plus yet. I'm almost.
I am. I'm 60, and I agree with you, but this is not how I felt when I was 25 years old. You know, it's different.
And
when
I never played games with women. I didn't. I begged
right.
them.
Right.
And that's not a work. Game.
That's,
I think
that doesn't work. That's terrible.
I think sports is ruining our culture. I think everything's a competition now, and love is now a sport. Instead of just finding someone and settling down and getting on with your life and having sex and caring for one another, constant games.
I'm out of it now. I don't hit on women anymore. I've never gotten married, and I'm very content being a solitary man. But
have you ever gotten laid, as they say, negging a woman, putting her down?
Mm-hmm. You gots to do what you gots to do. Oh, I got. Can we just stop for one second? No, not stop your show. But I got it. I just remind me the way I said. Do you remember Clint, Dirty Harry? You've seen Dirty. Every guy listening has seen Dirty Harry. Yeah. Like the Bible, and you know it. So, if the, you know, like 5-10 minutes in, there's that bank robbery scene, which is the most famous scene. Do I have 6 bullets in the gun or 5? What do you think? Do you feel lucky? Blah blah blah. So that guy, the black guy, that he says that to, you know, he goes, I know what you're thinking. Blah, 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 blah. Did I fire 6 shots? If I, and then the guy, and then the black guy takes his hand away from the gun, and then Clint Eastwood kicks the gun and starts to walk away. And the black guy goes, I gots to know, right? And then Clint Eastwood turns around, pulls the trigger, and it was an empty chamber. And he goes, son of a bitch. So that's, if you've seen that scene 12 million times, that guy's indelibly printed in your brain. So that's 1971, I believe that movie was done, or 70 or 70, I'm not sure. Anyway, it's now 1999, and I'm on a commercial audition for beer. I think I told you this story, didn't I?
No.
And they want goofy guys and black men. So that's the call. So you got goofy guys like me and black guys, and it doesn't, and any kind of black guy. That was like the whatever it was. So it was the guys having a good time. So I walk in. There's only 2 people at the audition, and there's the guy. I mean, how can you not? And it's all these years later, but that's and I'm sitting there, and I can't study the lines because I'm just looking at him. Go, that's the guy. Gots to know guy. I can't believe it. There he is. You know, that's my favorite. One of my favorite films. So, like an idiot, like a moron. This is a professional gig. And I go up and go, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but are you the I gots to know guy? And he like looks up from his script, and he goes very calm, very sweet. He goes, yes, that's me. Shakes my hand. How did you know? And I go, I love that movie. I mean, yeah, I can't ever get that look of your face out of my brain. And I go, people must bug you like this all the time. He goes, no, but thank you for recognizing. I want to go back to the script. I go, no problem. And I'm reading the script. And now another guy signs in, and he goes and he sits next to me, and he's going over his lines. He gets up. He walks up to the guy and goes, excuse me, I don't want to bother you, but are you the I gots to know guy? So basically this guy gets the, are you the I gots to know guy every day. He passed away a few years ago, but he must have gotten that everywhere he went. And I looked him up on IMDb. He's in another Clint Eastwood film where I think he's got, again, one line. So this guy maybe in his life in movies got 3 lines, 3 lines more than me, but 3 lines. And he, you know, he's absolutely recognizable to any American guy, you know, for decades, for 40, 50 years. Isn't that wild?
Tell me about Archie Bunker.
I can go back to that story.
I want to talk about Archie Bunker.
Okay.
Unless you have something. Did you forget something?
Well, I mean, the girl thing is endless. I mean, you asked me, I'll tell you Archie Bunker.
Well, no, tell me about the girls. If you got something, I got to know.
If I negged girls in your term, if I did saying something out of left field to startle them, and the answer was yes, and that's what you got. That's what you do. I mean, it's a cruel world out there. But when boy meets girl, if you aren't blessed with if you aren't blessed with overt good looks or what women overtly want, then you got to really fight harder.
You have to be mean to them.
No, it's not that mean to them. You just have to catch them off guard. Again, every guy goes up to a woman, "You're the most beautiful Miss Crabtree. I'm in love with you, Miss Crabtree. Miss McGillicuddy was nothing compared to you." I mean, it's just like you just become a little rascal and you just melt in front of a... You remember, "Oh, Miss Crabtree, when I think of you. Oh, Norm. Oh, Chubsy Upsy." You remember that whole thing? I mean, that's what...
The little rascals, yeah.
That's what every guy is all about. It's just like, you know... being infatuated with whoever they are with at the time.
Don't respect somebody who can't think straight around them.
Listen, it's the age old thing. When you see bikers with a hot babe strapped them, and these guys are obviously, they could be good souls, but they're cruel guys. They're violent, whatever, they're involved in things, or gangsters when you see these gang rappers on television and they've got beautiful women. Women, come on, we know all. I mean, that's out in the public. Everyone knows that women like bad boys. That's not even a thought. So if you have any kind of... Look at this guy with that model guy, the guy that was in prison with the mugshot. He's in the news now, you know, and he's going out with a billionaire. He's going out with a billionaire, hot-looking chick from England. And this guy's married. It's not even that he's gotten divorced. He's married with children. He's such a bad guy. He's with her, and she can't wait to play with him with the billions of dollars. It's the world is, boy, girl, it's kooky.
When you're around a woman,
yeah,
and you're aroused, and you can't talk, and your head is spinning, and you're trying to pretend you know what you're doing.
That's where these books come in.
Women don't find that as a compliment.
Don't find what as a compliment?
That you're weak at the knees.
Of course not. No. You're like a dish rag. You're like all the other idiots. That you're not interesting. You're not keeping. You're not making them laugh. You're not.
So women are accustomed to guys just being like that all the time?
It's Darwinism. You know, we are here. Men are here to propagate and to. Fathers, I'm not talking about now. I'm talking about, you know, as a biological species. They're here to progenerate. Is that the word?
Whatever. I would think that a woman,
women want to select the best genes for their children. That's kind of why Woody Allen, why those movies were so funny, because here he was winning over these drop dead gorgeous women that normally would not like a guy like that, but he was using his intellect and his humor and getting what he wanted, because that is his strength and that's his genius, and women want, they are there to, you know, to produce good offspring. Powerful. There's all different adjectives that it doesn't mean you want a good looking man. It's not all about good looks. It's about power. It's about the way someone carries themselves.
So they
know all
powerful this. Sperm and good offspring come from a man who's not completely into you. Is that what you're saying?
I guess so. However you want to look at it. I can't go. We need 4 hours, and I would need to go over my notes and remember all this stuff. But this is just biology. You don't. Go back to Vikings. Go back to people where they had to conquer other people. You didn't go for the guy who was sitting drooling in the corner to tie his moccasins. You didn't go for it. I think I want to have children with that idiot over there. But there's Lars. Lars is 6'2". He takes the sword and chops off 15 heads in 12 seconds. He's like, well, that's who I want. I want Lars. I don't want the Lenny in the corner. Jeez, David, I mean, you're asking me such stupid questions.
But women complain. But women complain. He's rude.
Look at Derek Jeter. Derek Jeter's married to that woman. I can't remember her name, but I'm a big Yankee fan. I can't remember her name. She's a big actress. And she's tall and she's gorgeous. And he's tall, he's handsome, and he's Derek Jeter. So you got these two great people, and they're having a baby. You know, I mean, that's, you know, they're like pulled toward each other. You know, I mean, this, I'm not talking like in a eugenics way. I'm just saying this is like these people have a good shot of having good offspring, except for stand-up comedians. Stand-up comedians, when they have children who then want to be stand-up comedians, big problem.
Why?
Because generally they don't succeed. Stand-up comedy is one of those qualities. You know, even acting, Henry Fonda had the two kids and they could act. Maybe I think he had another one, or the grandson's an actor too. But stand-up comedy, it's so difficult for the children of stand-ups, and you know, we know a lot of them, to achieve what their fathers did.
Or they're much more successful. So, okay, we'll move on. I want to get to Archie Bunker, then we'll wrap it up.
Or they're much more successful. Yeah, I know. But generally, no.
Saying to a woman, I'm not like the other guys. I'll worship you. I'll be kind. I'll be considerate. We'll have sex. I'll make sure you have an orgasm. I'll take care of you. I won't leave. I'll be here in the morning. Already I'm beginning to hate myself and be clingy. It's too clingy, right?
I don't know about that, but let's go into this fact, okay? You know the expression, the best go first, okay? There is a percentage of the population, okay, that are okay. They've been blessed psychically or psychologically. They're okay. They're good people. They come from a solid foundation. They don't have a history of drug addiction or alcoholism. They're intelligent. They're solid citizens. And I have to say, like, this I can't even give you a percentage, but let's say it's probably like more than 50% of people are good people. You know, they're just out there. They're quiet. You don't see them. They just do their thing. They can be in any job, any social position, everything. And they find each other. They find each other in a college. And because they're not neurotic, they're not driven. They're just not driven in a negative way. They're good people. And they find each other. Okay, then that leaves everybody else. Everybody else is demented. They have problems. They have insecurity issues. They have drug issues. They have father issues if they're a woman. They have mother issues if they're a boy. And all these things start to twist. And the longer you don't commit and the longer you remain single, these deviations become the norm for that person. So you're dealing with walking wounded. And so these books are for the walking wounded, how to get laid. Through all this nonsense, you know.
I think it's a car ride at night dating. I'm driving.
Yeah.
And it's dark, but my headlights are working, and we get to a winding road, and she says, "Turn the lights off." What lights? Turn your headlights off. But it's a winder. Turn them off. They're crazy. I'm normal. I'm just trying to get the car into the garage, so to speak. And the women I tend to meet are a little, they like the drama. They want it scary and dangerous. And I'm thinking, can't we just have a quiet evening and not crash the car?
Right. Again, this is human nature. It's, I'm not a doctor. I can't, you know, I know this is a radio program, so I just can't sit here and speculate so much, because these are not facts. These are just based on my relationships with people, with thousands and thousands of people, being a social person that I am. But yeah, people are whacked out. But I'm just telling you, on the flip side of the coin, there are normal people. You just never hear of them. My sister is like such a normal person. She lives a few blocks from you in New York. Got married young. That's it. Kids. She's a hard worker. She's like a woman's libber. She's a vice president of a corporate. You know, she's like, my sister's a solid. If you were to put my sister and I in a room, it'd be like, you know, what's wrong with this picture? And the arrow be pointing at me, because I'm what's wrong. So I don't know from those people. They're good, solid people. You don't hear about them because that's what God or whatever wanted people to be like, not like the whack jobs like us.
So you tell know, me the Archie Bunker jobs. Story. I love this story. I haven't heard
Can
it.
Can I just tell you one
yes.
more story?
Yes.
So this thing worked for me, these theory. And I went out with a lot of women, and I was with some very beautiful women I should never have ever been with. But because I was a performer, and you go on the, you know, you're in Portland, Oregon, and you've got this effervescent personality. First of all, a sense of humor is unbelievable. Aphrodisiac. And I make jokes about it in my act, but the bottom line is it's unbelievable. It's the only thing more, I guess, is a rock musician or a baseball player. And what's funny about rock musicians and baseball players is rock musicians want to be comedians and baseball players want to be rock stars, because I've met baseball players and rock stars, and it's all interchangeable. I want to be a baseball player. George Thorogood, you know who he is?
Mm-hmm. The Destroyers.
Very nice guy. He wants to be a comedian. But those three professions are the big girl getting professions. And he married Marla, who used to hang around at the Improv, and she was an artist, I forget. But they're, you know, married for a zillion years, children, the whole thing. So, but yes, they all want to be comedians. Anyway.
It's six o'clock.
I have it set to Australian voice, so it tells me in an Australian accent.
About the Archie Bunker.
Archie Bunker. All right.
Well, go ahead.
For another time, we'll talk about the psychiatrist then.
No, tell me about the psychiatrist. Go ahead.
So I met. Well, I'm telling you, I did not deserve some of these women. I met this woman, 1999. She was a psychologist in Los Angeles. You know, one of these women that's always, they use her on television where the sister's sleeping with the father, who's sleeping with the uncle. And then they have the, you know, like on the, what was that guy? The bald black guy with the marijuana. What's his, Montel Williams. They were all the Jenny Jones. She was on all those shows and trying to get, anyway, she was so phenomenal. Oh, she beautiful. She looked like Meg Ryan, just like Meg Ryan. Oh, but she had very large breasts on top of it. And she was so beautiful. I couldn't believe this woman wanted to be with me, but she liked me. And the funny thing is I've dated psychologists before. They're crazier than their patients. That's the irony of it all. But we would be on a date, and I'd just be staring at her going, I can't believe I'm with this woman. She's phenomenal. How is this possible? This is unbelievable. And she'd be going, you know, Bruce, we've been together now a couple of weeks, and I can't help but use my opinion, but I think you have attention deficit disorder. And I would sit there and go, Deborah, you're absolutely right. And then under my breath, I'm going, when I take you home, I'm going to rip that bra off with my teeth. I'm going to jump on you like a gorilla. And she goes, I'm going to send you to my psychiatrist friend. He's going to put you on medication. Oh, no problem. I did whatever she said. So I'm 2 days later, I'm at a psychiatrist's office and I go, Deborah thinks you have my girlfriend thinks I have ADD. Well, do you think about a lot of things? Yeah. And the guy, next thing I know, the guy's writing me a prescription for Ritalin. This is a hardcore, I don't know if your listeners know, it's like a speedy kind of a thing. And that's not good for me. I don't like to be speedy. I like sleeping a lot. Anyway, this guy gives me Ritalin and I go, I'll give it a shot. I take one Ritalin. 3 days later, I haven't gone to bed yet. I've cleaned my apartment with like a toothbrush like they do in prison cells. And I'm like, what has this turned me into? I'm like, oh my God. So I flush the Ritalin down the toilet. That's the end of it. But Deborah, like, you know, a week and a half later, and I tell her, you know, I don't think that worked for me. And she goes, you know, I've been thinking about it. You know, you're right. I don't think you have ADT. I think you have obsessive compulsive disorder. And I looked at her and I said, you know, it takes a genius like you to figure this out. And then I'm going, tonight, I'm going to pull those panties down so fast. It's going to cause friction marks. I'm going to jump on you. And next thing I know, I'm at another psychiatrist. I go, my girlfriend thinks I have obsessive compulsive disorder. Well, what are the things that she thinks? I don't know, but this is what she says. Let's get it over with. And he gives me a prescription for something called Effexor. And this is like, what's that stuff? Prozac. Is it Prozac? Yeah, it's like a Prozac thing. This is for people, God bless them, that need it. But I'm just taking it because I'm just trying to get laid here, you know? And The thing was like 4 pills a day. So it was, I think, 150 pills. And the Walgreens said, we only have 75. We're going to give you 75 today. And then tomorrow we'll have the other 75. I go, look, I can't go through. Don't worry about it. I go home and it says, take the pill at 10 o'clock at night. I take that pill at 10 o'clock that night. At 11 o'clock, an hour later, I don't know what I've taken, but it isn't good. It's turned me, I still to this day can't describe what I felt. I felt like inside out. I felt like I was on the wall looking down at me. It was the weirdest thing. So obviously to the toilet, and I flushed the 74 pills down the toilet into the Los Angeles water system. And then I get a call the next day from Walgreens, your other 75 pills are ready. I go, I don't want them. I go, but by law, you've been prescribed them. They're yours. You have to pick them up. We don't care what you're doing. So I went to Walgreens. I picked up the pills, and I threw them into the gutter out in front of the store. And that's it.
And when did you break up with Deborah?
Well, then she was admitted to a mental institution. They took her away. So that was the end of her.
No, seriously. Was she admitted into a mental institute?
No. When I want to get a laugh, I say that. But... I still think she was great. And, but again, I'm not, I don't really want to go on. I like telling that part of the story because of the fun part, the funniness of it. But I do think she's a great girl and she's with somebody now. And I wish them the best, but I'm just whatever I am. I like the Neil Diamond song. I'm a solitary man and I love my life. So now you want the Archie
Bunker. Next time you come on, we'll do the Archie Bunker.
Okay. All right.
Do you worry about being alone?
This is the greatest thing in mankind. And I know a lot of people, I have friends, these 60-year-old guys who live in fear of being alone. And yet they try to meet women. And do you think they're trying to meet 58-year-old women so that they can be normal and live old together? No, these idiots that are afraid of being alone are trying to meet like 28-year-old women that need a green card that they think are going to go out and get a 24-hour-a-day job. These guys are so crazy. So I feel that I have processed everything. I mean, I overdid it with the women. And I never had a long-term relationship, and I've become like a selfish, selfish human being. I'm as bad as, let's go back 1 second on these pickup books. We make the jokes and we make the laughter, but they really do work. The problem is they should all come with a warning that if you practice this form of lifestyle, you pretty much can never settle down because you're always going to be looking for something else. And you look at women, you value women less than you should. You look at them more like an object or a toy than you do as a human being and a loving.
Wait, I'm not listening to that part. They really do work? these books work?
I told you they work. We've been spending an hour talking about.
I have to say, they totally work. I have to say that
I would show you my bedpost, but it fell apart before all the notches. It just disintegrated.
I will admit this. Looking back, yeah. I was reading the game, and I was with a friend, and we went out on a double date, and he negged this woman, and it worked.
Yeah, of course. What I resent...
It's horrible. It's horrible.
What I resent are all these guys that stole Eric Weber. It's just a basic book, and all these guys read his book, and they all wrote a book based on it. I mean, everybody, that relationships, people do that. There was this woman. Did you ever go to Pat Allen, Dr. Pat Allen in L.A.? She's got to be in her mid-80s now. She's wonderful. She had the best Monday night seminars in
Who's
L.A.
Who's Dr. Pat Allen?
She's the greatest. She's been running, if she's still around, I mean, just purely by age, if that has tired her out. She's a psychologist who wrote books on women who want to get married and how to stop their nonsense and to, how to filter through all the nonsense and really meet someone of substance and not, and basically stay away from people like myself. That was her whole thing. And she used to do these at theaters in LA on Monday nights. And I don't think I ever missed one. She had them every week, 52 weeks a year. Even if it was on Christmas Eve, there would be a Pat Allen meeting. And it was always fun because these were real people. No one used their last name. It was like an anonymous meeting. And there were like studio executives. There were all these people. It was mostly women. It was like an 80-20 ratio. And these people go, Pat, yes, I did it again. What happened, sweetheart? Well, you know, I run, they don't mention the studio, and I make, you know, I make $19 million a year. But I met this guy at the beach, he has long hair, and I can't get him off my couch. And he's so good looking, Pat. And Pat would go, yeah, we talked about this 2 weeks ago. You're supposed to get rid of him. And you say, until you bring ring, that's our big thing. Until you bring me a ring, we can't commit. I know, but he's so good looking. Because what happened? Happens in Los Angeles. And
so wait a second.
Power.
So she's teaching girls, women, ladies how to get married.
Yes.
I see.
Folks, getting to I Do. It's her famous book.
Well, why are you there? This is for women.
Because my act was all about relationships.
They allow men to show up?
Sure, sure. I mean, men have issues too. Men would get up and talk to her too, because not every guy was a bad guy like me. They were good, solid guys who were getting run around. Oh, it's the greatest. If it's still going on, anyone who lives in the LA area, just find out where it is, Dr. Pat Allen. And first of all, you know that matchmaker, that millionaire matchmaker TV show, that girl, I think she gives credit to Pat Allen, but everything she does on that show is all taken from going to her seminars and all her little shtick. And Pat, it was some, because you would laugh. You would watch these people that you could never.
Would everybody laugh, or are you just laughing to yourself?
No, because people would go up there and you'd see this woman dressed in her St. John suit. And, you know, she says, I run a studio. You know, anyone who, a woman who's running a movie producer in Los Angeles, or a network producer, just these very powerful women who happen to be drop dead gorgeous, and they're idiots. They're as bad as everybody, and here they are making decisions. We're going to make this film. We'll put De Niro. No, Al Pacino. This is what they're doing. And then they're going home. Bobby's in the living room on my couch, and I told him he had to leave, but look at his hair. He has such beautiful hair. Look at I bounced quarters off his ribs. You know, and they're just as screwed up as these men who fall for 19-year-old stars. It's wild, and no one learns. No one figures it out. So they just come back. So it's pure comedy. It's just insanity. But you'd see the most powerful people in Los Angeles that can't figure it out. And, you know, we're all in the same boat. And then people kind of like team up and go, hey, let's go to Louise's for dinner. Because the seminars are like from 7 to 8:30. And everybody's enlightened because you laugh and I'm going to be a better person after I went to this thing. And then it's like being, you know, and you go and you bond or whatever. Mm-hmm. It was great. That and Sushi House in West L.A. I think those are, and El Pollo Loco. Those are about the only three things I miss about L.A. And an Astro Burger. So four things. But that was Pat Allen. I mean, God, if I could go into a transporter, I would go every Monday still to L.A. to go to her lectures. There's so much fun.
Jimmy Lee Wirt works on this show.
Yeah.
And when we would tape at KPFK, we'd head home and stop off at Astro Burger because they have vegan fare.
Yeah, they do. Yeah.
And I would pig out at Astro Burger. And I never felt sick the next day because it was just a clean veggie burger. It was all clean.
Well, I never got sick on their hamburgers. Astro Burger, that cheeseburger, bacon, no, not bacon, the chili cheeseburger with well-done fries. Wow. You know, here in Florida, there's some decent hamburger places, but Astro Burger, I liked it even. I like Fat Burger, but Astro Burger, it's still good. I went to L.A. earlier this year, and I went there, and it did not disappoint me. Still it's great.
And you don't disappoint me. Bruce Smirnoff, I'll talk to you next week.
Bye-bye, pal. Happy 4th of July.
You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.